Members, we have a quorum. This is the appointed time. Mr. Tony Chair, please stay and help us start the meeting first. It will be quick. So we have a quorum. This is the appointed time. Please go back to your original seat. This is a reminder for you, Ms. Tanya Chan. Members, please note the information papers issued since the last meeting held on the 20th of March 2020. Altogether, 5 papers have been received. Details are set out on the agenda, item 1. And then, items for discussion at the next meeting. Ms. Tanya Chan, at the meeting of the 20th of December 2019, proposed to discuss the relevant clearance procedure concerning passengers traveling to Hong Kong, Zhuhai, Macau through the Hong Kong, Zhuhai, Macau Bridge. The Secretariat had consulted the Transport and Housing Bureau on the matter. And according to the administration, the clearance procedure comes under the purview of the Security Bureau and the law enforcement agencies such as the Immigration Department and the Customs and Excise Department. So the matter should be discussed at the security panel. The next regular meeting will be held on the 17th of May 2020 for discussing the following items. Yes, item 1 on the agenda. Ferry and water taxi services, reviving the central Hong Kong ferry service, introducing the water taxi service, and also improvement works of cycle track network in new towns, and later situation of automated dockless bicycle rental services. Any views? Yes, Ms. Tanya Chan. Thank you, Chairman. Relating to the May meeting, I have no objection. I see that the list of items also include the items for June. And if we take a look at the list of outstanding items, item 10 refers to the Hong Kong Zhuhai Macau Bridge. And according to the headline of a newspaper today, well, I'm sorry, are we, because the Hong Kong Zhuhai Macau Bridge, express rail link, have been closed for some time because of the epidemic. I suppose the financial position should attract our concern. I want to know whether we should discuss it here or otherwise, because it also touches on the operational matters, the financial arrangement, and also the triangular relationship with the MTRCL and the KCRC. So I want to know whether this will be discussed at the security panel or this panel, because we'd like to have a deeper understanding of the financial position. The Secretariat will follow it up with the security panel. But I do think that this is more appropriate if we discuss it here. Right, this is rather a big item. So we consult the administration. Any other views? If not, then we can move on to item 3, MTR fare adjustment for 2020. Let's invite the administration to come in. Members, if you wish to speak, please press the button now. Let me remind members that in accordance with Rule 83A of the Rules of Procedure, if there is any direct or indirect pecuniary interest in relation to any discussion item at today's meeting, please disclose the nature of your interest before you speak. So let me welcome public officers from the Transport and Housing Bureau and the MTRCL to our meeting. DS, you will walk us through the paper, right? I'll give some brief opening remarks, and then the MTRCL will walk you through the paper with the PowerPoint presentation. Good morning. The administration and the MTRCL would like to brief members on the MTR fare adjustment for 2020. The FAM fare adjustment mechanism was part of the mechanism set up during the rail merger from 2008 through open, transparent and a direct drive formula, the FAM determined the fare adjustment rate. And in 2013, the affordability cap has been introduced, adopting the median monthly household income as the threshold. As the fourth quarter of the MMHI value in the fourth in 2019 was a negative figure, which should be deemed as 0% according to the mechanism. Hence, the fare adjustment rate would be zero. As for the change in the CCPI Composite Consumer Price Index and the Nominal Wage Index Transportation section, the rate should be positive 2.5%. And having discussed with the government, the MTRC has decided to simplify the arrangement by recouping the overall fare adjustment rate, that is 2.55% increase in two subsequent years, that is 1.28% in 2021-22 and 1.27% in 2022-23 because of the unprecedented challenge arising from the epidemic. So having discussed with the MTRCL having discussed with the government, apart from this measure, from July this year to January 2021, there will be a 20% discount for MTRCL passengers. There will also be various fare concessions and monthly pass discounts available. Ms. Jenny Yang, Commercial Director of MTRCL, will now brief members on the details. Thank you, Chairman. Good morning, members. I thank members for giving us time here to brief members on the MTR fare adjustment for this year. I think we all agree that we are facing an unprecedented challenge, and we are significantly impacted by the unprecedented epidemic. Over the past few months, I hope members would see that we have been joining hands with the community in devising measures to tide people over the difficulty so that we can ride out the storm hand in hand. Regarding MTR fare adjustment this year, we hope that the actual fare would remain the same through our rebate measures. At the same time, we understand the increasing impact of the epidemic on our economy, and we have been offering one-off fare concessions outside of the formula so that in the long term we can still have sufficient resources to provide a quality service to our passengers and also for us to continue to improve our service. So let me highlight the salient points of our fare adjustment plan this year. Perhaps a recap on the FAM formula. According to the fare adjustment mechanism, the fare adjustment rate for 2020-21 should be 2.55% increase, including the 0.6% special adjustment outside of the FAM. Taking into account the economic situation this year, we have a negative figure for the affordability cap. That is, the MMHI year-on-year change for the fourth quarter of 2019 is negative or minus 2.48%, a negative figure. So it should be deemed as 0%. In other words, there will not be any fare adjustment for this year. When devising this mechanism, when it was introduced in the last FAM review, affordability cap was introduced to make sure that the fare rate would be affordable by the public. And it is effective. And through the simplified arrangement introduced last year, we have decided to recoup the overall fare adjustment rate in two subsequent years, that is in 2021-22 and 2022-23. Comparing to the original formula, and that is, we will introduce the adjustment before offering concessions. It will be a much simpler way of getting it around, and this is also accepted by the government. I want to emphasize that it is of great importance to our operation to have continuous investment in asset maintenance and renewal. And we have continuously invested heavily in asset management, asset maintenance and renewal. As our assets mature, it's a 40-year-old railway system. And just like the railway systems in other countries, more resources will be required to keep it up to date and for maintenance. In 2019, we invested over $9 billion in this regard. As for operating costs, over the years, the rate of increase has exceeded the fare adjustment rate. In 2019, the increase was 17.3%. I think we all understand why. Despite the spiraling operating costs, we do not want passengers to shoulder a heavy burden because of fare increase. It will still follow the FAM. As announced before, there will be additional resources so that we can continue to allow passengers to enjoy a 3.3% rebate without substantial change to the fare rate. There will be no price adjustment for monthly pass passengers. So for Octopus users and these pass holders, from the beginning of 2019 until January 2021, the fare rate will remain the same. And you may recall, on the 8th of April, because of the epidemic and the impact on our society, we made an unprecedented announcement on a major fare concession scheme. From the 1st of July to the 1st of January 2021, we will provide a 20% concession on fares.
So it is on the basis of 3.3% rebate, and then we have added, top it up to 20%. And for July onwards, for the City Saver, we will have $100 reduced, which is equivalent to 15 to 25% discount. And for the, we will have 1.6 billion revenue reduction for us. So it will depend on the patronage as well. The government has also said that half of the revenue reduction will be borne by the government, up to 20 billion. And if you notice that the stations as well as the commercial setups in the MTR mall and shop tenants will, from February to April 2020, will have a half month rent reduction so that they too can weather this storm and keep the employment of the employees. And we will continue to give relief measures, but it will depend on the actual situations of the enterprises. We welcome the suggestions by the public, and within our capability, we'll be able to, we hope to be able to actively respond to suggestions. However, we'd like to invite your understanding for the respect of the mechanism, because this mechanism plays a very important part for the sustainability of the MTR. It balances the capability of affordability of the public as well as reliable revenue for the MTR, because we need a lot of resources to maintain and enhance our operations, so that we need to strike a balance between the two. So this ends my presentation. Chairman, we discuss until 10, a quarter past 10. We have now 17 speakers who want to speak, so we'll have 3 minutes allotment for each. Mr. Luke Chung-Hong, thank you. The MTR Corporation Limited has frozen and has continued to have this 3.3% rebate and topping it up to 20%. So it is welcome news for the reduction of fares. However, for the mechanism, when are we going to have this review of the FAM? So we'd like to know whether there's going to be a cap for the profit, for the profits, and also for the calculations and the periods. For instance, for the Hong Hom derailment and for the Lagam, for another incident, the performance could be disrupted for a long time. And so the calculations of this sometimes is quite quite different from what actually happened. So perhaps for the as we look ahead for the economy, we'll envisage difficulties. So at the next review, can we not recoup this 2.5% in the future? That's the first point, the fare prices. Now, I have always thought that for the fare that we pay and the performance service, I think these two, there should be a balance. And also the employees' rights, because the employees' rights would have to do with the performance. For instance, the derailment in the Hong Hom station, the MTR Corporation says it is because of a lack of knowledge of the employees. However, I think there's a lack of guidance and shortcomings in training. And also, there's a wastage of very experienced staff. So enhancement of their payments, salaries, so that we can have a reform in order to retain experienced staff. That has to be reviewed. Otherwise, even if you increase maintenance of the resources, we still have a problem because of the aging of the system. Now, I'd like to say, first of all, the review of the FAM mechanism, that was reviewed in 2017. The mechanism would be working until 20 to 23, valid up to that time. And of course, before that day, we will have another review. As for recouping, if we are not to recoup the percentage increase, then that will mean that we cannot catch up with the inflation and with the employee salary increase, and that will have an impact on these two areas. The MTR Corporation Limited has a hefty profit. Well, I think we have to keep the time limit. As for salaries, you can respond to that question later. Mr. Kenneth Lau, the pandemic has hit very hardly on the economy. There's a 4.2% of employment, unemployment. So for the over 10 billion profit already earned last year, the MTR says that it won't change the fare price this year, but we will recoup this 2.5% raise for the future years. Well, we are now facing very difficult circumstances, so we'd like to have to break this recouping so that you don't profit to the maximum and that you will weather the storm with us. So we would like to see even a reduction in fares so that you will alleviate the burden, fare burden of the public. And you said that you will have 20% reduction, and the administration will shoulder half of the expense of this reduction. Apart from the 20% discount of fares, would the MTR have would it roll out more short-term concessions? Now, I'd like to first of all respond to the question that the administration will shoulder half of the 20% reduction of fares from 1st of January to the end of December. If we were to ask the MTR to shoulder all these amount of reduction, the corporation would not be able to do it. So we have decided that we would have some relief measures for the MTR so that the MTR can directly benefit the public in the matter of fares. As for the concessions of the fares, I'd like to say that you have raised questions in the several areas. The MTR Corporation would like to use various approaches to help the community. For instance, for the rental reduction in February, we came out very rapidly to help out the mall, to help the employment. Whether next year or the year after we will recoup our increase, we would like to see, wait and see the economic circumstances when the time comes. Mr. Kong Junyu, the public would like to call for the comprehensive reduction of fares. Well, you are saying that 20% of reduction for the 1.6 billion of revenue loss, the administration will shoulder half of it. Well, it is public money, and it's the public that is paying for it. So now we have 54.5 million of profit. And now you are saying that you have about 10.5 million of reduction, et cetera. Well, you have the Express Link Rail has stopped the service. Would we, the public, be paying for the losses? Now, we know that 1.6 billion, the administration is shouldering half of it, and now you are paying with public money for this kind of reduction. Would you have further reductions? Well, Hong Kong is not doing well. MTR should show their social responsibility to help the public, and you are saying that instead of apart from the half of topping up by the government, are you going to have further concessions? I hope that you would understand that MTR cannot stand alone for its own benefit. We know that we have a loss of 40% of passengers. And at the end of January, there have been border closures in Lok Ma Chau. So we have also suffered revenue losses. And we know that there would be a lot of difficulties. We have yet to make our performance known for the first of for the year. So we are doing what we can. Ms. Yuan, your profits is at 10.5 billion. We know that the commuting fares is a large chunk of the public's expenses. So for the express link, are you going to let us to make us pay for the losses? Well, we have a lot of expenses for the express link, and in the agreement, according to the indexes, so And I think the for the operating agreement, we have to stand by it. Mr. Lam Chak Ting, there is a permitted 1.28% of increase in 2021 and 2023 for 2.55, which means that these are not going to take place now, but could be recouped. Well, in these last two years, there are lots of incidents. Well, there are fake construction incidents. There is also a derailment of the Hong Kong station. There are serious incidents and serious disruptions. And now, you have half-year relief measures, but these relief measures are far from sufficient for the damage done to the public, especially the for the Sha Tin Central Line construction shortcomings. Now, this cannot make up for the management shortcomings. Now, be it making up for your guilt, you should have more measures to demonstrate your sincerity. You should announce that you will give up the 2.55% of increase, that you will do away with it.
Monsieur, well, I think before we agreed on the recouping arrangement for the 2.55%. For the original fare concession arrangements, 3.3% rebate for etc., there will be $800 million gone in our revenue. I think it would depend on the economic situation next year. We could still be in hardship. But by then, depending on these factors, we can devise a response, because by then there will be economic data and financial data available. Well, everybody envisages that the economy will remain bad. There won't be a rebound in the near future. But isn't it time for MTRCL to show this corporate social responsibility? You can set aside the 2.55% fare adjustment rate. Instead of recouping it, will you give an undertaking to let go of the 2.55% increase? Mr. Lam Chak Ting, you're already repeating yourself, and Ms. Yang already said she will consider the factors by then. Ms. Claudia Ng. But for the fare adjustment for MTRCL, some rates will be frozen, some rates will be recouped later. I think MTRCL is insincere. It is deceptive because you will recoup the rate in two subsequent years, but you refuse to cancel the increase. In other words, you're only recouping the rate later. Isn't it cheating Hong Kong people? And then also 20% fare concession per trip. This will be subsidized by the government in half, and the revenue forgone will be $800 million. So this is like robbing Peter to pay Paul. It's after all coming from public coffers. $0.8 billion. It's not a small sum. Well, let's see if she will take my question. Ms. Xu Mei, again, cite the FAM. And it's true that under the current epidemic, people are staying at home and your ridership has dropped. However, many people, especially young people, are saying that your company serves the Communist Party. What's your feeling on this? Chairman, let me take the question on what has it to do with you? As we said before, We understand that the MTRCL will not be able to shoulder the special fare concession between July and January next year. And I'd like to supplement on Ms. Young's point. Be it the express rail link or cross-boundary services, including Lo Wu and Lok Ma Chau stations, because of suspension of these stations' operations, their fare income has substantially reduced. And also, the fares for local rail lines have also dropped. And that's the reason for the government's commitment to the 20% concession for 6 months. Can I finish first? Well, what about the $12 billion net profit of the MTRCL last year? I think Ms. Claudia Mo should refer to the figures and the information. For the $0.8 billion, it's half of... Yes, I know, the government's commitment is subject to a cap of $0.8 billion. I am talking about... $0.8 billion coming from the public coffers. How hypocritic are you to debate with me like this? Well, we see that the ridership has dropped by 40%. And the epidemic is now gradually coming under control. Do you have any idea whether the ridership in this quarter will improve? And to what extent? It is important because it also has a bearing on the operational matter and staffing matters of the MTRC in the future. And in your conclusion, you mentioned the high-speed rail Hong Kong section service suspension and Lo Wu Lok Ma Chau stations being closed. We're concerned. Under what circumstances would you resume cross-boundary commuting service? We understand, of course, this is not really up to you, but do you have a mechanism to discuss with the mainland counterparts what are the criteria and what are the conditions for service to be resumed? Have you reached that stage, or are you waiting for the Department of Health to give you orders? I suppose Ms. Yuan would take the questions. How about I take the latter question first? Chairman, about cross-boundary commuting service. Apart from rail service by the MTRCL, we'll also consider land transport. And like Mr. Yu Siwing said, we need to give regard to the development of the epidemic and also the overall situation for the government to decide when it should be resumed. The MTRCL is under active preparation. Like Ms. Yang said, they have not made any staff redundant and their operation can resume in a short period of time, but this is, after all, closely linked to the development of the epidemic. I just want to know whether there are criteria, there are conditions to meet so that once they are fulfilled, the government can resume service. The general principle in considering the epidemic is, of course, whether we still have confirmed cases locally and whether the epidemic is under control in the mainland. It is at the moment. And on these technical matters, the MTRCL and other operators have devised mechanisms for resumption of service. Ms. Young, any prediction? We have prepared different scenarios. It depends on visitors, tourists, how many they are coming in or leaving before we can project the ridership, and also whether there are other health or infection control measures or measures related to social unrest. So there are a number of factors we need to consider. I would say that at the moment it is difficult. In terms of our company's financial position, we do see a great challenge. Mr. Jeremy Tam, A brief question. The increase will be recouped in two subsequent years, in 2021-22 and 2022-23. At the moment, the rate will not be adjusted because of the negative figure of the year-on-year change in MMHI value in the fourth quarter of 2019. Let's say in 2021-22 or even the following year, 2022-23, the MMHI value is still in the negative, then will you adjust the rate upward, Ms. Yang? The answer is simple. If the figure is deemed zero again next year, there will not be any increase. So the rate is pegged to the economic situation and income. So whether we will recoup the increase next year, it really depends on the economy. Right, next question. In 2017, you conducted a review on the FAM, which should expire in 2023. So to pick up on my last question, let's say in 2021-22 and 2022-23, you recorded a zero or even negative figure. That means the increase will be further postponed. However, this current proposal only remains good until 23. So will the proposal expire in 2023, or will there be a new mechanism? Let me take this question. Under this mechanism, the government and the MTRCL should have a discussion. This proposal will remain good until 23, but the review will be conducted before that. And should the scenario arise, as Mr. Jeremy Tam suggests, we will factor this in our review. But this is unreasonable. You can't conduct a review when it expires, because unless in 2017 it hadn't occurred to you at all, you could have told us that, say, if it is not recouped before 2023, then that's it. It's impossible that this was not discussed in the 2017 review. If you can't answer me at the outset, that means you hadn't considered in 2017. Well, let me elaborate on my answer. Say, without a review, in theory, the fair adjustment mechanism should remain in place. So we need to play by the mechanism. Say in 2024-25, the rate could still be recouped. However, of course, before 23, we need to review the work in subsequent years. And if there is some to be carried forward, we need to consider that in our review as well. If, however, without a review, then in theory, the rate could be recouped in subsequent years. Mr. Lam Chi Chang. Thank you, Chairman. Well, in theory, in light of the current economic situation, fare should be adjusted downwards. So I would say that MTRCL has done some soul searching already. I'd like to refer to some figures. You have an item, maintenance and repair. In 2019-18, it increased by 90%. So for the second half of last year, because of the black clad violence incidents, the train cars, the stations were heavily vandalized. So what is the loss involved? It has very much to do with this recouping of fare adjustment. I don't know how much money you've spent on repairing these properties. Do you have any information for us? Because, well, Mr. Chen Hanpan once said that it entailed $1.5 billion. I don't know whether this figure is true. And the pandems continue to adopt scorched earth politics. And it is still unknown whether we can resume normal ridership. So originally, you should reduce the fare rates. Now you could only freeze the fare rates, all because of the doing of the pandemics. So can you answer me this question? Without the vandalizing activities and the losses, whether you should just freeze the rate or reduce it. Well, the total repair cost now stands at $600 million, and repair is still underway. Without cost on repair, according to the mechanism, this is not pegged to the fare rate, so the MTRCL will need to shoulder the cost solely, and we will only need to consider affordability cap, the economic situation. But because of the epidemic and the social unrest, unemployment rate is record high, is standing at 4.2%. Will you factor in the unemployment rate as well? I suppose you set the fares last month. We have provided a 20% concession. This is a special concession outside of the FAM formula. But indeed, with a drop in revenue and more pain out of our pockets, we're trying our best to do more. So say for the LRT, will you reintroduce a monthly pass to boost ridership? And will you take this question as well? We have monthly passes for different lines. I'm referring to LRT. We do not have this plan at the moment, but we'll give it a thought.
Chairman, I have noticed in this fare arrangement, you are now have promoting 20% reduction for 6 months due to exceptional circumstances. There is going to be a very serious downward trend of the economy. So I hope that exceptional circumstances with exceptional approaches, that you will have a 20%, will welcome the 20% reduction for 6 months. I think that is not sufficient. You can extend the 6 months, because we don't know yet when the pandemic will end. And even after the pandemic, we'll need time to recuperate. And the public will still have a heavy burden economically. So we hope that you will extend the period of such 20% reduction. I hope that you can respond positively. Now, apart from the fares, you have also mentioned that for the mall as well as for the shop rentals, you will have some relief measures. For the small and medium enterprises, you have reduced half of the rents for February to April, which means that it will soon end this rental reduction. Would you continue such half rent reduction? So I'd like to know how these can be set. Your first question, for the we have already carried out a half rent reduction for February and from February to April. In our press release and consultations with the enterprises, we will do our best, and we will have relief measures also in May for these small medium enterprises. For further down the road, we have to see, and we are facing a lot of challenges. We cannot look really further down the road. However, for the rental reduction, we have taken rapid measures already, because we understand the difficulties involved. And it is a matter of definition for small and medium enterprises. And for this definition, we have a relaxed criteria. And for the bigger enterprises, we'll look at their performance, and we will do our best also to help. Mr. Lo Wai Kwok, thank you. For the our party, we have consulted with the secretary, and we have expressed very clearly that under these pandemic, the Hong Kong economy is being hard hit, and for the public, the commuting expenses are really a heavy burden. So there will be a 20% reduction up to the end of this year, which from July to end of December. That is a good thing. So for the grassroots, especially if they take a long haul commuting, the 20% reduction will enable them to buy something else with a reduction. Well, we hope that such a reduction should be rapidly implemented. Why can't you advance it? And why do you wait until July for this 20% reduction? As for rental reduction, you said that from February and to April, that would be applied to small and medium enterprises. Now we are approaching the end of April. All trades are being impacted upon. So do you have future plans beyond April? I will speak on the rental, and Mr. Yun will speak on the date. For May, we have already discussed with the the rents, but the rents reduction would not be across the board. We will look at each and every cases. And in the last two days, we have already also replied to the press questions in this area. For 20% reduction, it will involve the light rail, bus, and the MTR. We need a lot of tests if we are to go beyond this system. We need time to have this 20% reduction being implemented across the board, and we need time to test the system. If you can say very clearly that you would walk hand in hand with the public to ride out this storm with the public. Mr. Cheng Chung Tai, 800 million to be paid by the administration for this fare reduction by the MTRCL. I think that this such a measure will impact on the minibuses, because this will be negative for them. MTRCL is, relatively speaking, nearly a quasi state enterprise, and such an approach will have a negative impact on the other modes of transport. Why is it that you cannot advance the date for such a 20% reduction? The reply is that it is a very complicated system. I can't accept such an answer, because we have a very bad impression of the MTRCL. In 2018, we had a lot of incidents, and to calm down the public opinion, then you are having fare reductions at that time, one-off. And why should you have only fare reductions on public holidays and maintain full fare for the weekdays at that time? That was what you did. So I can say there was a for the March call made that you should have a 9 month reduction and not only 6 months. Well, don't tell me that it is technically complicated. You should improve the public's impression of the MTRCL and advance the date. Well, let me speak on the MTRCL with the other modes of transport. We have reduced the threshold of the concessions because we hope that all commuters using different modes would also benefit from the reductions. As for the impact of our reduction on other modes of transport, and there are different different relief measures from the administration for the other modes of transport. Well, I forgot to draw the lines. After Mr. Tony Chair, I will draw the line for speakers. Mr. Tony Chair, under this pandemic, all trades and have suffered. And for the public, they also suffered. The MTR is the most used mode of transport, and it is only fair that there should be a fair reduction. There are different views on the amount of reduction, percentage of reduction, and on the period of reduction. I've always said that for public transport, and when the threats of the pandemic will be lessened, then we would go back to our normal life. If only MTR is reducing its fares and other modes of public transport are not reducing their fares, it would give an impression that you are giving benefits to the MTR. For the MTRCL, they are saying that they have rising operating costs, and it has risen from 2019 to 2020. Well, you have rising operating cost, reduction of fare revenue. However, the commercial shops of the MTR, I don't know how much of these rents are being counted as operating revenues. This for other modes of transport, the administration are also taking care of it. For the first and second stage of relief measures, we have about 6.3 billion of relief measures. For buses, we have 800 million relief measures. Well, if we ask them to reduce their fares for the other modes of transport, well, it is very difficult. We can do half and half with the MTRCL. However, Mr. Chairman, you would know that it would be a very complex affair to do otherwise for the other modes of transport. We are reducing the the threshold of the relief, then it is possible that we might have a 20 or 30% for the other modes, but that has to be looked into. Well, we will discuss that also with the MGRCL. The last speaker with Mr. Hu Qiwai. So the next one is Alvin Yang. So the concession would be implemented as from July and the date cannot be advanced. The MGRCL replied that it's because of the complicated system. Well, for the computer system, well, I'd like to know why is it that they would need such a long time to straighten out the computer system? Well, are you saying that we will save costs to have such policies? We hope that there may be more passengers. So it is not saving costs for the computer operation. I will ask my colleague to reply. Mr. Yun? We said that the reform of the system includes the light rail and the other modes. So we need to have a very accurate testing because all the fares have to be calculated in a very accurate manner. Otherwise, there would be chaos. The public would not know whether the 20% are indeed applied. So we need a lot of human resources to have accurate testing to make sure that the 20% reduction is being accurately applied.
I'd like to supplement that apart from the 20% special concession, we also have other concession schemes, such as the early bird discount promotion. So we do have a whole package of concessions for our riders. And testing of the system would be required so that the special concession can be rolled out on the 1st of July. Chairman, assuming that it really takes so long to get ready, and this is also the first time they're offering such comprehensive one-off fare concessions, I hope that next time MTRCL won't take 8 weeks to get themselves prepared. Can we do that? I think it's very reasonable for Mr. Yang to make this suggestion. I don't think we will take 8 weeks next time, but it definitely will be quicker. Mr. Fun Xiuping. Due to the epidemic and its impact, the MTRCL has unprecedentedly rolled out a series of concessions. Now the rebate will start from the 1st of July. I want to know whether you can advance it a bit. Fare revenue is one of the major sources of your income. Now, like other members asked just now, whether pay adjustment for staff will be affected. And also as pointed out in your papers, the operating costs have increased significantly by 17.3%, and it has not included the cost of repair and maintenance of facilities because of vandalizing activities of the black clads. If you take this in as well, I want to know the total operating costs, Monsieur. On implementation date, as I already answered that question, I won't take up the members' time. On staff payroll, we have another mechanism. Despite the impact on the operating costs, we will strive not to affect our staff. However, we do need to consider a basket of factors, and we'll need to strike a delicate balance between different needs. Now, 17% or 17.3% rise in operating costs, whether it includes the repair of facilities. It's absorbed in the recurring expenditure. But we also have depreciation of facilities which require fresh procurement, and this is not included. The same accounting rules apply. It depends on the item. But this does not include the cost of repair and replacement, according to your footnote. So what exactly do you mean? The footnote? This does not include the cost of repair and replacement of equipment incurred due to vandalism. So 17.3%. Yes, we'll take the question. How about we go back and verify the information first? Yes, give him a written reply. Mr. Poon. Because the crux of the matter is the staff payroll should not be affected. So I hope you won't just give a simple statement. You want to strike a balance, and hence there will be a pay freeze, or there will be no pay hike this year. I hope you can give this promise. As I said, we have a mechanism for pay adjustment. It's not pegged to the operating costs. Next, Mr. Ban Chen. Please switch on his mic. Chairman. Some members asked about the complexity of your fare system. Well, your fare structure is likewise very complex. I wrote to the MTRCL in February for information about a review of the mechanism and the criteria for adjusting fares. I haven't received a reply from you. Coming back to the paper, on the first half of last year, the MTRCL made a profit of $950 million. But because of social unrest in the second half of last year, you had a cost of you incurred a loss of $1.54 billion. And altogether, you had a loss of $1.3 billion. So you were also heavily affected by the social unrest incidents. And for the special fare concession, you will pay half of the total concession, $0.8 billion. But had it not been the black clads, you would have reaped another $1.6 billion. And anyway, we're in such a chaos, and the economic the economy is going south. And yet, according to the FAM, the formula comes up with a 2.55% increase. It shows that the FAM is somewhat ridiculous, and it is not reflecting the true picture. The government should take a serious look into the matter. Despite the social unrest, the FAM still applies, and the MTRCL can continue to raise the fares by 2.55%. So the government should review the FAM as soon as possible. I also made a suggestion on fare decrease by 30% in three subsequent years. I made this suggestion because despite the economic situation last year, MTR still managed to earn a profit of $10.5 billion. So the MTRCL is fiscally sound, and there is room for fare decrease. My question is, why can't you roll out the fare concessions and reduce rates? DS, let me take the questions on FAM review. We note members' comments. And I want to emphasize that the FAM is based on information available in the public domain, such as the CCPI change and the NWI transportation section. There may be some lagging effect, but overall speaking, it reflects the general economic situation at the time. And also, there'll be a deduction based on the MMHI and the outcome of the overall fare adjustment rate and recouping of the rate is a result of taking into account the MMHI value. It's recouped, not cancelled. Well, my suggestion is that the government should heed the views of different sectors in the next FAM review, because indeed it is not in line with the current economic situation. Mr. Michael Tian, Deputy Secretary Choi and Commercial Director Yang, the two of you have my respect, and I know that you two are really smart. I want to play a game with you. It's called Let's Make a Deal. For monthly pass of franchise bus companies for passengers of using monthly passes at the moment, taking into account transport subsidy, bus interchange concessions, MTR and bus passengers pay the same. After the special fare concession, bus commuters will need to pay more. Comparatively speaking, for a bus journey from Tumon to Central, the monthly pass is $70 cheaper than an MTR monthly pass. But in the future, the monthly pass for buses would be $55 more expensive. Don't throw the book at me. Don't tell me about the one-third increase and also the BBI concession, etc. I've taken everything into account. So I think it's a big deal. In the coming 6 months, those bus commuters will all switch to MTR because it's cheaper. And then West Rail will be jam-packed. And as a result, bus departures will be less frequent because of a drop in ridership. So it will be a big problem. So my deal is this. The government should fully subsidize all public transport for 6 months so that they can have 20% concession, and buses should be included because buses, I mean, franchise bus companies are private companies. They will need to pay for the 10% for the concession, whereas MTRCL, the government is a major shareholder. So, Ms. Young, how about we ask the government to subsidize another 10% so that in the coming 12 months, you can give a 4% rebate across the board? Because 20% for 6 months equals $0.8 billion, which means you can provide a 4% rebate for 12 months. And then 12 months later, we will continue to have a 4% rebate, and it will be a win-win for both MTR and bus commuters. DS, will you consider it? Isn't it great? Well, as I mentioned just now, there are still a lot of uncertainties. Ridership is one factor. Well, just don't beat about the bush. Just give it a thought. It's a win-win. Well, at the moment, there have been substantial drops in terms of bus ridership and MTR ridership. Even for other forms of public transport, in the first and second round of the anti-epidemic fund, the government has provided heavy subsidies to these public transport operators. It will be difficult to give more, but anyway, we will go back and give it a thought. Yes, work out the sums. The time is up, Mr. Tian. I think Mr. Tian has expressed a very, very important point. Well, he referred to buses. And then my sector would also complain the minibuses are not subsidized. So in terms of the fare structure of the public transportation system in Hong Kong, they are all linked, and I think you need to look into that very carefully. Mrs. Regina Ip is not here. Mr. Peter Shou. Thank you, Chairman. First of all, I thank the MTRCL on the 11th of September last year, Mr. Tommy Cheung and myself met with the MTRCL representatives on behalf of my constituents in the catering retail industry for rent concession. And on the 18th of February this year, I met again with Ms. Young, again on rent concession. Then in February, March and April, the MTRCL has reduced rent for about 50%. Our sector is grateful. In fact, many businesses in my sector have planned to introduce downsizing or even to close a business. So we would like to thank the MTRCL and the shareholder of MTRCL. In the coming 6 months, there'll be a 20% rebate for MTR commuters, costing about $1.6 billion, according to Ms. Claudia Mo. She's aggrieved because $0.8 billion will be shouldered by the government. But I think we all know that the government holds 72.5% of shares of MTRCL. So even if it's not forked out from the government's pocket, after all, it all comes from public coffers. So in other words, the government's paying $200 million for a 20% rebate for everyone for 6 months. I think the majority of Hong Kong people would agree. We should thank the shareholders of MTRCL. I believe, against the current backdrop, the shareholders would show support. However, in the past 6 months, some facilities of the MTRCL were vandalized and they needed to foot the bill, and it's not fair.
There are children under 18 to vandalizing the MTRCL. So what are the guidance? Are you going to go after these under 18-year-old or their parents for damage done? Thank you. As for the last year's, second half of last year with the violence occurred, damaging the MTRCL equipment. So in different cases, we will go after the damages done in the cases that we know about. Well, for the 25% reduction of fares for all trips, 800 million will be borne by the government and 800 million by the MTRCL. Over 70% is owned by the administration. So it is, in fact, the public that is paying. So that is why we would like to have a direct rebate. I'd like to know, for the 20% discount for 6 months, How do you come up with that? Is it because the administration says we'll fork out 800 million and you fork out 800 million and altogether it is enough for 6 months? Well, if the administration is not willing to borne half of the of this 1.6 billion, would the MTRCL still have this 20%? You also mentioned that the small and medium shops that are renting the malls of the MTR for February to April, you have given them such reduction. Well, so you are doing it of your own accord without any government subsidies. Now, can you apply the employment scheme so that would you apply for this employment scheme? For the 20% reduction, do you have do you have any more space in that, that you could do a bit more. For the one-off 20% reduction for 6 months, it is the result of agreement between the government and the MTRCL. And the administration has also expressed the wish that there can that could be larger reduction. However, the MTRCL, faced with a sizable decrease in the fare revenue, so that is why we have reached an agreement of half and half, with the administration shouldering 800 million, with a ceiling of 800 million. Now, for the employment scheme, it is not applicable to the MTRCL, and the MTRCL is not taking part in that scheme. Mr. Hu Qiwei, I have two questions. Well, this reduction of 20% of 6 months, it will disappear at the end of it, and fares will jack up. Now, can you tell the passengers what would happen? So what would be the situation for the fares after 6 months? So this time, it is a scheme agreed upon by the MTRCL and the government. Because of the differences in prices of the different modes of transport, there will be there would be a change in the modes of for the different modes of public transport. Well, you have to deal with this, such price differences between the different modes of transport. Well, you are saying that the subsidies would also be up to 200. Well, the threshold, you can also lower it down to zero. Well, in this case, that all commuters, when they choose the mode of transport, they would have direct reduction of fares for all kinds of transport. So would you adjust it downward from 200 to zero, so you can have a level playing field, a fair competition ground for the different modes of transport, and not only have a policy for the benefit of the MTRCL. The government's act will have a policy that would be benefiting one side at the expense of the other modes. So would you change such a way of benefiting one mode? Would you lower the threshold from 200 to zero so that there will be a level playing field benefiting all commuters and all modes of transport? Well, we have relaxing the subsidy level, subsidy threshold. Well, if we lower it down to zero, there would be a widespread abuse. We are thinking of whether we should have further reduction. Are you saying, well, then the MTR reduction will also lead to abuse? I am saying that the scheme of the transport subsidy would be could be abused, because many commuters, because the commuter subsidy scheme would only be available after payment, but we hope that in fact the lowering of the threshold that we have been envisaging, it is in fact about 20% reduction for the modes, and we are or have already balanced between these different modes of transport. So time is up. I'd like to thank Mr. Hu Jiwei. You are, the balance should be struck between the different modes of public transport. I hope that you will have a new study for the Transport Advisory Committee, that you will look into the matter of the different modes of transport and their fares. You have to strike a balance because your policy might cause damage to the other modes of transport by this policy for the MTRCL. Well, thank you for your attendance. We will come to the fourth item, a comprehensive review of private driving instructors' licenses. I'd like to invite the officials to attend. You can press the button to speak now, members of the council, of the panel. I would like to welcome the Undersecretary, Dr. Raymond So, and his team. Would you have a presentation? Yes. Chairman, I'd like to briefly present the comprehensive review of private driving instructor's license and our recommendations. In every 2 years, we will have a review of this PDI licenses. We have reported on the 2016 review. In 2018 to 2019, for the PDI, the benchmark, the mechanism of issuance, and also the quality of the PDI, we have undertaken a comprehensive review. We have four reviews. We maintain the two-prong approach for training. So under this two-prong, we have DDIs, and we encourage, apart from the public roads, to give training. And also for the PDI, we have allowed them to use the roads for training. And for this two-pronged approach has been supported. As for the light buses, the group one, the private cars and light goods vehicles, we have now 1,075, and to have it raised to 100 and to increase it by 120. So now for the second group and the third group, the light buses and medium goods vehicles, heavy goods, there are enough PDIs. So we are maintaining the bench levels for these two groups. So we feel that such a two-prong approach is proved to be valid. So for TD, we will optimize the PDIs. So for the second group and group three, as well as the restricted PDI, we will have an approach where we will have 75% of the group one to open it to the public for application. And for the 25%, then we will have allow the group two and group three, and as well as XRDIs, to in recognition of their driving competence and training experience, we allow them to apply. And C, for the new issuing mechanism, we will have a new issuing mechanism. We will have the same proportion for the applications. And we will also enhance the quality of PTI so that they would have a good example in the attitudes. For instance, we raise the qualifications so that the increase the 3 year up to 6 year. So in the preceding 3 years or 5 years, they will not become, they would have no conviction of careless driving and dangerous driving. And also they would have a mandatory pre-service course. And for the license holders, they would have a mandatory refresher course. And in the cars, they would have to display an identity plate so that they there will be to deter illegal driving training services. We have a working group with 14 associations as members, and we have three PDI groups as well as RDA trade representatives. There are two divergent views, and that is laid out in paragraphs 18 and 19. So we have two stages. In the fourth quarter, we will invite the public to apply for the 159 licenses, and afterwards we will invite the remaining ones to apply. Thank you. There are seven members who have asked for the floor. We have half an hour. So now we have eight, so we have 3 minutes each. Mr. Kwa Wai Kung, I'm not a member of this panel. There is a GP1 association, PDI association, so we have to speak for them. The trade union is not satisfied because this has ignored the rights of the G, the Group 1. Well, the Group 1 license are to be open and have a quota for Group 2 and 3. And they think that this is not appropriate. Every time for the PTI in Group 1, if the number is falling, then the applications will be open to everybody to be to have the licenses of the Group 1. It is open and fair. However, you have 1/4 quota amounting to 1/4 for Group 2 and 3. However, for many years, those who have not been able to apply because of the drawing of lots, even though they follow all the rules, they have applied. However, today you have a special queue for the groups 2 and 3. However, for those applicants who have been unsuccessful, who have been waiting for a long time, who are hoping for another employment opportunity, you are now closing this door for them.
As for Group 2, Group 3 PDIs, are they really put out of jobs? Why are you giving them special quotas? And because of the epidemic, the enrollment rate has dropped as well. So in future, they would like to get more businesses to make up for the losses in the past few months. And now, if it becomes more competitive, they cannot make up for the loss they've incurred. So that's a question for the Bureau or for Transport Department. There is no need to set aside the driving instructor quota for PDIs in Groups 2 and 3 to join Group 1 PDI license applications. So I wonder if you consider the union's views. Who will take this question? Thank you, Mr. Kwa Wai Kung, for the comments. The purpose of the new mechanism for new PDI licenses is for maximize or optimize the use of manpower in PDIs in Group 2 and 3 as well as serving RDIs. Mr. Michael Look. It all started with Group 1 PDI licenses and the conflict between PDIs in Group 2 and 3, as well as the conflict with DDS, designated driving schools. We need to handle the conflict in a delicate manner. After all, we are all trying to make a living. We don't want to see any conflicts. Let me give you an example. It happens recently. That is the Continuing Education Fund, the CEF. Why is it only available to the Hong Kong Motor Driving School? In fact, it's dominated by one major group, and of course, they are the winner. But for PDIs not working for Hong Kong School of Motoring, they suffer a loss. They're losing business. So Continuing Education Fund, it may not be related to somebody's work. They may not be professional drivers. So apart from the Hong Kong School of Motorings, if PDIs offering on-street driving training, can they form a group or a company and hence be eligible for the CEF as well? Undersecretary, thank you, Mr. Lok, for your comments and your questions. Regardless of the mode of operation, any operator can apply with the CEF with the eligibility criteria met. There should be accreditation with the council and also for the Education Bureau to include the or Labour and Welfare Bureau to put it on the register. These courses should relate to work related training, and as such, there is no restriction on the registration of relevant courses. Operators can follow the two-step approach as mentioned and apply to be registered with the CEF. As for assessment and accreditation, the Labour and Welfare Bureau is happy to provide advice to potential applicants, and free advisory service can also be provided. The Education Bureau will also reimburse the fees partially to successful applicants. Undersecretary, in short, you're suggesting that the CEF is open to all operators if they meet the criteria. Ms. Alice Magnix, we have 9 members waiting. I'll draw a line afterwards. Ms. Mack, of course, we support measures to enhance the quality of PDIs. We need to keep our streets safe. But Undersecretary, you should not just read from the script. Don't read from the papers. You just answered members' questions by reading from the papers. Now you have a new licensing or issuing mechanism for licenses. You are giving special quotas for GP to groups 2 and 3 PDIs. But how do you enhance the quality by doing that? Can you answer me? Also, you mentioned that if you want to join the qualifications framework, you can provide some help. What about the PDIs, existing PDIs? If they want to run these courses, will you really provide actual help? If so, I'll ask them to do it. Thank you, Ms. Mack, for the 2 questions. On enhancing the quality of PDIs, we have a comprehensive review of the mechanism. When I responded to Mr. Kwai Kung's question, I mentioned that we should optimize the use of the expertise of PDIs in Group 2 and 3 so as to enrich the learning experience. Sorry, I need to interject, Chairman. I don't have much time, Secretary. I need you to clarify my question and answer my question more directly. To make good use of the expertise and experience of PDIs in Group 2 and 3. I want to know what expertise or experience they have, which GP1 PDIs don't have. Well, we need to make good use of their experience and expertise, and we have a two-pronged approach. And there are also other measures in the mechanism. For example, for license renewal, once every 3 years, they need to take mandatory refresher courses and also the pre-service course so as to enhance the quality of PDIs so that they can exchange views with their peers and also have a better understanding of the latest traffic situations. And this would overall enhance the quality of the whole trade. This is the multi-pronged approach we're taking. Chairman, I didn't ask Secretary about these courses. I asked quotas reserved for groups 2 and 3 PDIs, how this could enhance the quality of the trade. You answered something like experience and expertise of groups 2 and 3. What about group 1? Don't the PDIs have them? As I said, they can we can tap on the expertise and experience of PDIs in group 2 and 3. Ms. Elizabeth Kwan. It has been a long-standing problem over the past two or three decades. We have had a lot of debates on the matter. The DAB is concerned with the enhancing the quality of PDIs and road safety. We have many licensees not practicing. So we have a shortage of PDIs at the moment. And we don't have many roads available for on-street driver training. And as you know, Chairman, it takes many hours for learner drivers to learn how to drive, and it's expensive. So we should maximize the use of existing resources. And in fact, we support the measures for enhancing the quality of PDIs. Ms. Elsmack asked Under Secretary about the expertise and experience of Group 2 or 3 PDIs, which Group 1 don't have. Well, we're not talking about a lot of quotas, just 57. I don't know why the Undersecretary couldn't answer this question, but let me say this to Ms. Elsmack. For GP2, 3 PDIs, we have the masters driving large vehicles, dump trucks, container trucks, etc. They are qualified to instruct learner drivers on larger vehicles, but not small vehicles. But many such experienced instructors are also instructors of PDIs, despite the fact that they cannot directly be PDIs for private cars drivers. And this is really ridiculous. Why is it that for the trainees, under their instruction, they can apply by drawing lots to become Group 1 PDIs, whereas they have sufficient experience and awareness of road safety matters because they drive bigger vehicles, and yet they are not qualified for Group 1? Now we have fewer large trucks on the roads of Hong Kong, and their income has dropped. So I think their views should have some merit, and they have the experience. I see that only 57 quotas have been set aside for GP2, 3 PDIs, and it's not a large number. It's reasonable. I support the government. However, in the future, in terms of the streets available, the driving test venues, etc., the government should improve these areas, because traffic congestion is caused sometimes by insufficient streets available for learner drivers, and you should improve on these things. Next, Mr. Ben Chan. I have a similar view with Ms. Elizabeth Kwan. Say, existing PDIs, of course, may be in a bit different position than a fresh PDI. just like the difference of competence between a serving teacher and a new teacher. Say for GP2 and 3 PDIs, definitely they have more experience on the road than a fresh PDI, since they can coach larger vehicles. And learning to drive is very expensive. We have PDI licensees not practicing. There aren't many PDIs available in the market, and we should allow more veterans the opportunity to teach driving. Because from the public's perspective, it is also in line with public interest. These masters are experienced and they are also qualified. We should allow them to teach smaller vehicle drivers as well. And in future, the government should also review the mechanism, see if we have sufficient licenses, and if we have more and more retired PDIs, the government should consider issuing more licenses. Any response from the government? We thank Mr. Ben Chen for the valuable views. We conduct a review on a biennial basis on the factors mentioned. We conduct analysis on the number of PDI licenses to be issued. Mr. Ray Chen, Chairman, about the proposed issuing mechanism for the new PDI licenses, I believe the change is reasonable. The most controversial point is for the remaining 57 new licenses to be set aside as driver instructor quota. Of course, those currently enjoying an advantage might feel that their interest is undermined. I understand where the union's voice is coming from. But from consumer's point of view, or as a learner driver, what we want is to have more PDIs, more experienced and qualified PDIs for the market.
For the DTS, the instructors also have accumulated experience. Perhaps we will allow more competition. Then for more PDIs, then the fees would perhaps go down, which is not what the PDIs would like to see. Now, of course, with more PDIs, then we have more learners. Would there be a longer queue for the driving tests? Would you, in this case, add to the number of examiners for driving? How many are they, in fact? We are increasing the licenses in order to make up for the increased demand. So we feel that such an increase would meet the needs and would give the public more choices. For these qualification, we would need, you have five subject matters passed in the school leaving exam, and you should have grade 2 for Chinese, I think. Now, for the DSC, now we are adding qualifications such as that they should not be convicted for dangerous driving or under alcohol, driving under alcohol. Now, are you going to increase the number of examiners? In our review, we have an assessment. Of course, during the pandemic, there are fewer learner drivers. However, experience showed that we would have some increase nonetheless. We have now increased the PDI by 100 more. There are 17 venues for testing, driving tests. So I think that it won't be any negative impact. Of course, any change would impact on the vested interests, those who benefited from the system. From 1999, there had not been any change at all. Paragraph 9, it says that from 1999 onwards, there's a 25% of increase in the test forms sold. So you are now proposing Group 1 PDI and increasing the numbers, and I think that there's a need for it. I'm not talking about any personal or trade interests. We have to look at it from the interest of Hong Kong. For Group 2 or Group 3 instructors, for DDS instructors, well, you allow them to go to Group 1, apply for Group 1. They are experienced trainers. So if they can turn into PDI for Group 1, they are experienced trainers, in fact, and they are not the newcomers like those who succeeded in drawing lots. So that will increase the standard of the PDI and the passing in one take could be increased, because there won't be any repeated tests. So that will also reduce the traffic jams when testing. So that's for the benefit of all. I'd like to also support the refresher course every 3 years, because there could be a lot of changes during these 3 years. So these refresher courses would allow them to refresh their knowledge and also their approach in training, and that's a good thing. As for the DDS, the instructors sometimes face difficult situations, because once they are rejected by the DDS, they cannot teach elsewhere. So now that's an escape route, so that there's 25%, whereas the restricted instructors can also have an escape route to be qualified for the Group 1. Now, the revision is negative vetting for this legislation bill. So we will do what we can to speed up the process. Mr. Ho Kai-ming, Scorch Earth people are entirely ignorant. And I think this document is something that we would object to, because it's a special cue for the DDS instructor to obtain the license, which means that the RDIs, the restricted instructor, would accept lower salaries to be able to get into the DDS, and then they also enjoy the DDS enjoy several advantages, where they pay lower salaries, and where they have subsidies for their training. So such an approach of a quota for these DDS would make it in such a way that the Hong Kong School of Motoring would enjoy all the advantages with lower salaries and with a special queue. Well, thank you. I'd like to explain or clarify. Mr. Ho's views expressed, I'd like to have some clarifications. In this new mechanism, we have taken into consideration different views, and we have also undertaken consultations. I'd like to know whether this is only one setup that would take advantage, full advantage of your proposal. In reply to Mr. Luke Zhonghong, it is not one setup that can run these courses. All other all the other entities that would like to provide such courses can also be allowed. So here we don't beat around the bush. Is it only one setup that can benefit from all the policies of the government, whereas the other companies or setups cannot benefit? Are you tailor-making such a policy for this particular company or setup? Well, we are talking about issuance of licenses. Well, you are you're protecting this setup. I don't understand. I do understand they are fighting for the benefits of the trade unions. However, this document is proposing an opportunity for the instructors in the DDS to allow them to be able to get out and become a PTI. There is a space that given them, a rotating door to get out. I don't see why you should be against it. As Mr. Jeremy Tam has said, this is a space given them so that these instructors in the DDS would not be under the thumb of the DDS forever. So I think this is a very important point. Is my understanding correct, Undersecretary? Thank you, Mr. Young. This mechanism would allow 25%, that is to say, about 57 DDS instructor and other groups, they can be qualified. These restricted instructors would be qualified to apply. That's one more option for them. Well, you mean that the employees from the DDS, or if you are not a DDS employee, then you would have to draw lots together with the other 75%. Now, the government's change is to increase the PDI pool. You are increasing the pool so that there will be more choices. Is that understanding correct? Well, yes. Technically speaking, you are increasing options for individuals, and also you are giving the DDS restricted instructors a chance to become a PDI. So you are giving 57 quota. In the future, are you going to refuse this figure? Do you have plans to refuse this figure? We are trying now to enhance this mechanism. It is early, too early to tell whether we would have further reforms, but every 2 years, we will review the whole mechanism. We have still two members who would like to speak for the first time and three for the second round. Our time is up to 45 past 12. Now, I think we'll need to extend our time. We'll give 2 minutes to each speaker. Any objection for extension of the meeting? No. Mr. Tony Chair, after listening to the debate, for the PTI, the threshold of qualification is high. Well, we of course would like to have more we'd like to have more choices for the consumers, for the learners. So we're looking for a fairer approach. That's the first point. Secondly, for the increased licenses, number of licenses, 25% would be given to the Group 2 and Group 3 instructors, whereas 75% would be open to the public. So for these 25%, would that be unfair to the first group? Thank you, Mr. Chair. As for the learners, learner drivers' options, the market is open. So the learner drivers can choose their schools, or they can also be trained by PDIs. They would look into their personal choices, their time slots, in order to choose their trainers. So this mechanism would keep these two-pronged approach, whereas given more choices to the consumer. As for the 25%, would that be unfair to Group 1? Well, our idea is to have a fair mechanism so that we can enhance the training and the teaching of driving. As the 25% would allow the restricted instructors, as well as groups 2 and 3 instructors, to apply. So we can take advantage of the experience of these instructors, and that will in turn enhance the level of training.
Whether it's unfair to Group 1 PDIs, I believe under the existing mechanism, we have balanced the interest between, we have balanced divergent views. We've struck a balance and whilst achieving the policy objective. I just want to say that because of the private driving instructors' method and the DDI's method, I want to know whether you have any statistics about the learner driver's choice, the ratio between PDIs and DDS. According to the paper, it's 70 to 30. So 70% PDIs. Yes. Next, Mr. Roy Kwong. Chairman, first of all, there's another meeting going on in the next room. I hope that I can follow up on the right for a question. First, PDIs are not qualified under the CEF, is that right? And this remains unchanged, is that right? About the CEF, they would need to be registered with the QF register. I answered Mr. Michael Look a similar question before. From the government's point of view, you need to meet two criteria. You need to apply for assessment under QF, and then you can apply with the CEF. For course providers, they can apply for assessment and accreditation. My question is this. If you want to learn to drive, you do not get the $10,000 subsidy under CEF, but now you're qualified, and then the most the simplest way is to go for the Hong Kong School of Motoring because you will be qualified for CEF. Now, at the same time, can I get a PDI whilst receiving the $10,000 as well? The answer is no. It's not incorporated in the mechanism. Some PDIs previously criticized the government for this. it is unfair, and I think the government is aware of the situation as well. So, say if you have the same pool of resources, $10,000, $20,000, how can you make sure that this is available to PDIs as well as TDS? Yes, the market is open. Maybe I can give you more details. Any course provider, regardless of the mode of operation, can apply for the course to be included in the CF list. First, they should apply with the Hong Kong CAAVQ for the course to be incorporated on the QF list and also for it to be put on a CEF list. So they should apply for accreditation with the Hong Kong CAAVQ. So I have a simple question. How many PDIs have joined this mechanism? Because you said it's so simple. We don't have this figure at hand. It's impossible not to have this figure. You need to know about it. You need to allow members to know about it. In theory, you should be able to answer us. If you say it's as simple as filling in some application forms and that stats, then you should have the figure. This is under the purview of the Labour and Welfare Bureau. I will reflect your view to the Bureau. Maybe you can provide an answer in writing afterwards? Yes, please. Next, Mr. Kwok Wai Kong, 2 minutes. Yes, Chairman. Well, let me say this with calmness. Those with vested interests are not PDIs, but the Hong Kong School of Motoring, because the Hong Kong School of Motoring have mistreated their instructors, and it is widely known. The union now agrees that there should be quotas available to the public once and for all, without a special quota for DIs. Some members thought that you're providing another exit for the abused DIs in Hong Kong School of Motoring, but this is not true. This only provides a trap for DIs so that they will continue to stay in the Hong Kong SM and be abused. Be more discerning, members. The Transport Department now is helping the Hong Kong School of Motoring to dominate the market and abuse the instructors. Drawing lots is okay, it's an open process, but if you provide a special queue for the HKSM, you are backpedaling. Any response? I thank Mr. Kwok Wai Kong for his comment. Mr. Kwok Wai Kong, no follow-up? Next, Mr. Jeremy Tam. Chairman, I still don't see the correlation. The point is, these instructors are trapped in the Hong Kong SM, and if you have an open drawing of lots, you have 10,000 places, etc. But now there is a special quota for them to have a way out. They'll be lifted of their plight. I really don't understand what the problem is. Say if the Hong Kong SM will attract new blood as a result, there will also be leavers. And the outgoing, if the outgoing instructors forms a critical mass, it will cause the Hong Kong SM to improve their conditions. It is not guaranteed that the HKSM instructors will definitely be balloted. They will have a higher chance because of the special quota. Now, in principle, they should represent the interests of the labor sector. I don't understand why these members are so strongly opposed to the idea. Well, of course, I understand that there is protectionism. You don't want new drivers to compete with the existing driving instructors. But this is not about vested interests. In fact, we have applicants who won't be active instructors. They may join the draw first. They may not practice anyway. What about existing driving instructors in Hong Kong SM? They definitely will be the active group. After they go through the drawing process, they will switch to PDIs. And this is a win-win situation. We can eliminate the inactive PDIs. But of course, if you ask me, there should not be any differentiation between PDIs and also DIs in DDS. We've now made the slight change since 1999, and it's already very fortunate. I hope this can be implemented as soon as possible. Your time is up. Next, Ms. Ho Kai-ming. I don't know if Mr. Jeremy Tam is really ignorant or that he just refuses to understand the matter. We have the Hong Kong SM recruiting DIs. Well, you get a low pay, but you can stay here for a few years. And when you get a PDI by drawing lots, you have five times the chance of winning if you are DI in the Hong Kong SM. And this provides an incentive because of the special quota. DIs will be incentivized to stay. Otherwise, you will have to join the public queue. Mr. Jeremy Tam, it provides a huge incentive for HKSM to retain their instructors. Well, some instructors may be happy that they are given another avenue so that they have a way out. And yet they will be recruiting new blood, and they will be entrapped in the same fashion. So what's the relationship between the government and the HKSM? Why are you allowing them to monopolize the market? There used to be two DDS. Now you have only one, which controls a number of centers. What's the reason for giving them special incentive? Because they are not treating the instructors well. What exactly is the relationship between the government and the HKSM? Any response? I need to reiterate, as per Mr. Ho Kai-ming's point, under the issuing mechanism for PDI licenses, it is open, transparent, and fair. And we also have the two-pronged approach under which we can ensure road safety and give regard to traffic condition and give sufficient choices to learner drivers about our bias. Giving favors to a particular DDS, we don't agree. There is only one DDS in Hong Kong at the moment. Mr. Ho Kai-ming, you pressed the button again, but we've drawn the line. I think it's almost time. I'll give some concluding remarks. I think the administration has heard us. I heard the divergent views here. Group 1 PDIs, of course, we need to fight the corners because there will be more competitors. But I discussed with you as well. In fact, the impact would not be significant. But I understand their concerns, having discussed with them. Say, for a mandatory refresher course once every 3 years, that is the same requirement applicable to other professions, but they do have a strong view on the exam that comes after the mandatory refresher course. They are, after all, getting quite old, and they are worried about whether they could pass the exam. So perhaps you should clarify this point, Undersecretary. And also, it is beneficial for the market for more instructors to apply for license for larger vehicles. It would be quicker for them to get a license for Group 3, and likewise, the speed of the queues for Group 1 and 2 will be quicker. And there should be a bigger pie so that serving PIs will be reassured. I know that this legislative exercise will be carried out for the new mechanism to be implemented. I don't know how long it will take, but I hope that in the course, the administration will continue to liaise closely with the stakeholders and see if there is room to further improve the mechanism. Thank you for attending today's meeting.